Tantor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents Contemporary Fiction, A Very Short Introduction by Robert Eaglestone. Narrated by Christine Williams.
Chapter 1. Saying Everything. Literature thinks. Literature is where ideas are investigated, lived out, explored in all their messy complexity. Sometimes these ideas look quite simple. What if you fell in love with someone who seems quite unsuitable for you? What happens if there is a traitor in your spy network? Sometimes they might appear more complicated. How can I reconstruct my memory of an event I can't recall? Perhaps, too, think is not the right word. Think is too limiting a description of the range of what a novel can do with ideas. In any event, the way literature thinks is bound up with what it's like to be us, to be human. Literature is how we make ourselves intelligible to ourselves. And contemporary fiction matters because it is how we work out who we are now, today. I believe the novel is the best way of doing this. Of all the arts, the novel is the most thoughtful, the closest, the most personal. Unlike the visual arts, or architecture, or music, or computer games, the novel uses only language. Nearly every one of us is an expert user of language, and more importantly, nearly everyone is an expert creator in language. Every day we use words to express ourselves and to tell stories, to make patterns out of our reality. We all share and thrive in language. We are much more intimate with the novel's medium than we are with theater or film. Unlike much poetry or painting, fiction has narrative, sometimes in complex ways. We share this with the novel, too, because each of us, in the stories we tell every day, is a skilled author and weaver of narrative. We can all judge a novel by the high and demanding standards of our own use of words and stories, and by our own patterns of reality. Because it takes longer to read a novel than it does to see a film or to listen to a piece of music, and because novels demand more time and energy, they are more immersive. This is the origin of phrases like, losing yourself in a book, or the book speaks to me, as if a novel was more than just ink on a page or words on a screen. We live in novels more than in any other art form, and after reading them, they stay with us. And after reading, the novel is still the art form most deeply and directly engaged with us. More than this, the contemporary novel is the best way of thinking about who we are now, because fiction is also the freest of all the arts. Despite many attempts to create one, there is no real watertight definition of fiction. It's not simply made up. It doesn't just tell a story. Originally, definition meant the setting of bounds or limits. It's not at all clear what the limits of fiction are, or indeed if there are any. The controversial French philosopher Jacques Derrida, who thought and wrote a great deal about this, described literature as a strange institution, and argued that the institution of fiction gives in principle the power to say everything, to break free of the rules. He defines fiction as a form of writing that has no definition, no limits in what it can say. The most important consequence of this is that a novel can respond to any aspect of the world that the writer is interested in, can be about anything, and can take any form or forms it chooses. The world is multiple and complex. So is the novel. There are no hard and fast rules for reading or writing fiction. A novel might go absolutely anywhere or do anything. This is the idea, this excitement, this freedom of the contemporary novel that underlies this book. This unbound freedom of fiction, in combination with the huge number of novels published every year, too many each year for any one person to read in a lifetime, also means that, in contemporary fiction, there can be no real experts in the conventional sense. Who, anyway, could be an expert on flowing quicksilver that can go anywhere? But thinking about novels in this way, thinking about how they think, does offer ways of avoiding common pitfalls. For example, what a novel thinks is not the same as what an author thinks. some book reviewers and journalists, perhaps inadvertently, suggest that we can only appreciate a novel in the context of a writer's life, and some writers play up to this. Often, this means that we pay attention to the correlation between two stories, the story of the novel, or a bad summary of the novel, and the story of the writer's life. Or in the case of contemporary fiction, we can listen to the author, her or himself, tell you what a book is about. Both of these mean that we no longer pay attention to the actual novel itself, which is surely why we were interested in the first place. One very excusable reason for this phenomenon is that it is actually hard to make out what knowing about a novel actually means. Knowing the plot? Knowing what it means while knowing that it means very different things to very different people? Knowing that it made you cry or smile? In the face of this uncertainty, turning to the story of an author's life or opinions gives a sense of security that some real fact is being told, or some real knowing about is happening. This seems to me quite wrong-headed. Knowing that a book makes you weep, or that it was boring, seems to me to be a fine subjective sort of knowledge. Knowing how it seems to fit into some bigger picture, finding its place in a larger constellation, seems to me to be a better, if more provisional, form of knowledge. And paying attention to its thinking, what a novel seems to be saying, seems to me to be the best form of knowing about contemporary fiction. But none of these is expertise, as the word is usually understood. This freedom of the novel also makes the question of how we work out who we are very demanding. We is quite a complicated word, not least because it includes and excludes simultaneously. Who we are, the communities of which each of us feels a part, is central to understanding the contemporary novel. The question is, who is the we made intelligible by a novel's thinking? The novel used to be seen as a place where a national tradition revealed and reinforced a community, a we. However, modern novels have become increasingly global. They cross and mix traditions and cultures, travel, and are translated. The idea of a national tradition of, say, the English or American or Kenyan novel has been bypassed by globalization. Optimistically, the post-national novel might suggest that readers could learn about each other's differences, hopes, and fears, and that our we could be infinitely enlarged. We might all become intelligible to each other. Pessimistically, some novels are ignored, misunderstood, or simply marketed as exotic novelties, and in the face of the whole world, our communities may become more defensive and less outgoing. Either way, the novel, like the human species, is now global, and the form is still coming to terms with this deep and recent change. A further symptom of this unboundedness and of the globalization of the novel is that there is no real agreement about when the contemporary is. We know the contemporary ends in the present, but when does it start? Traditionally, literary periods take their dates from watershed historical moments. In Western Europe, for example, the period of the contemporary might begin in 1945. Yet even within Europe, there are differences. In Spain, the contemporary might begin with the death of Franco in 1975, in Germany with the end of the Cold War in 1989, or reunification in 1990. Outside Europe, things are very different again. Contemporary might mean the end of the USSR in 1991 in Russia, or independence from Britain in 1947 in India. Different communities have different senses of when they are living, when the current moment began. More, the rapid historical and technological change through which we are living not only makes the past recede faster, it also weakens the very historical communities that define themselves by these sorts of dates. So perhaps watershed dates are not very helpful. In any case, it seems odd to mark a literary period with an extra literary event, however momentous. It takes time for historical events to move through into literature, and for literature to make historical events intelligible. Instead, perhaps the contemporary might mark the end of a previous literary age. The contemporary comes after modernism, perhaps, or postmodernism. Then again, did everywhere have modernism? And what did that consist of? This book aims simply to cut the Gordian knot of this sort of debate and say that contemporary means the last 10 years or so. This doesn't prevent contemporary fiction dealing with the past, the present, or the future, as I will show, but it does mean that in 10 years or so, this book will be out of date. But evanescence is no bad thing for a book about the contemporary novel. Chapter 2. Form, or What's Contemporary About Contemporary Fiction? Oscar Wilde said, "Form is everything. It is the secret of life." Michael Wood said, "If literature knows something or knows of something, then we shall need at some stage to ask what literary forms know or know of." The French-Russian experimental writer Nathalie Sarraute compared literature to a relay race, with a baton of innovation passing from one generation to another. And the experimental British writer B.S. Johnson added rather unkindly that the problem was that the vast majority of British novelists had dropped the baton, stood still, turned back, or not even realized that there is a race. So it's fair to ask, where is the baton now? What is the next big thing, the next big movement? But this question is really less about what novels are about, as they are about us, in all our human complexity, as how they work. It's a question about what's at the core of any literary movement or moment, literary form, and how form is understood. The underlying how. But if form is the issue, what is form? Irritatingly for writers, and very irritatingly for literary critics like me, there is no clear definition of what form means, even though it is such an important concept. Indeed, there are no clear definitions in literature. They are all leaky, vague, and should be abandoned when they are no longer useful. They are more like pointers drawing attention to an aspect of a work than a container to entrap it. Form is of those simple-sounding words that turns out to be very complicated. Roughly, form is not what is written, but how something is written. Form describes not the content of a novel, but rather the ways in which a novel embodies or shapes that content, how a novel works. Form and the decisions that form makes is what makes a novel different from, or the same as, because novels can do anything they want, a history book or a newspaper. But these types of writing have their own form, too. Form is the telling of the tale, and as we can't separate the tale from the telling, nor the dancer from the dance, that means that form is the core of the novel. Form is the writer's way of seeing and their way of telling. Form is what makes art artistic and literature literary. I can imagine a creative writing exercise about form. Retell this story as a detective thriller, as a romantic comedy, as a recipe book. Here the form would control how the story ended, what it meant. Form includes decisions about narration, too. Tell these events from the protagonist's point of view, or from a neutral, all-knowing observer's point of view, or as if you were the murderer and wanted to hide your crime. Things apart from plot are also decided by form. If the story is a comedy or a romance, it's unlikely to dwell on the plight of the starving street children. Conversely, if it's a novel about the state of the nation, then the young lovers won't be the center of attention, and the street children will be. Form also shapes the choice of words, the length of sentences. Hard-boiled thrillers have short sentences, a clipped vocabulary. Sentences in academic texts, on the other hand, are long and drawn out, characterized by subclauses, usually but not always, full of qualifications, and display a detailed complexity, certainly in their lexical and syntactic choices, their words and grammar. Form also is at the core of change in art and in literature. Artistic movements are first of all about form. When people talk about movements in literature, romanticism, modernism, they are talking not so much about the content of fiction, but rather the form. Form is a way of seeing and telling, and we measure movements in how their telling has changed, how it has made us see or think about the world differently. So when people ask, what's the next big thing in literature, they are not really asking, what's the next big topic, as if the answer could be the environment or terrorism. Instead, they are asking, how is the way this story is told going to challenge how we see and tell the world and ourselves? But very often, although it is the very shaping of the novel, form is invisible. This sounds an odd thing to say, but this invisibility stems from the origin of the novel as an art form and with the cluster of ideas around what is called realism. Realism, annoyingly, is also one of those words that sounds easy, but in fact is very complex. Realist does not just mean real, like the real world. Novels have always told real-world stories about ordinary people doing ordinary things, falling in love, dying, eating. And they have also told extraordinary stories, making human monsters, giant suits of haunted armor, wizards on broomsticks. For realism, it isn't a matter of content of the story, but of the way in which the story is told. Realism is a form that pretends to offer a window into a world through which one sees the events as if they were really happening, regardless of whether they are ordinary, falling in love, or extraordinary, flying on a broomstick. Realism is the dominant form of the novel. This is why so many novels can so easily be turned into films or television serials. The window is the screen. And yet, this is very strange. Realism offers a window through which one sees a world. But of course, in a novel, you don't see. You read. Reading and interpreting are very complicated processes at which we have become so proficient that we almost no longer realize we are doing them. When we read novels, we take things for granted, and we accept the conventions of realism. We read as if, for example, the characters in the novel are real people. That's why we feel, say, frightened for them, whether they are being threatened by poverty or a totalitarian police force. We read as if we expect one thing to follow another in the novel in a logical, cause-and-effect way, as if things have logical consequences. Importantly, from the first line of the first page, we read expecting an end to the story, expecting closure. Closure is what Frank Kermode, one of the leading literary critics of the 20th century, called the sense of an ending, and he argued that it was one of the most important and enduring features of fiction. It is the sense that a story is going to conclude, have the loose ends tied up, the bad ending badly, the good ending happily, and so on. Having the story finished. Of course, in the world of the story, some conventions might be different. We might accept that magic works and has a logic in one novel, for example, or that in another, the world of the story is just like our world, with the same streets and government ministers, where magic is just sleight of hand. But in a way, these are minor matters compared to the sense that we are seeing these characters, and that they are real, that they are in a story that has closure. It is these realist conventions that we are very used to. Indeed, we are so used to them that they have become invisible. We take realism in the novel for granted. Of course, realist fiction is never really utterly real. Sometimes we find things simply very unlikely. The man who randomly rescued this one lost orphan in London turned out to be the orphan's grandfather? Oh, come on! Or, oh, look, she never would really have fallen in love with him. And more or less, all the books we read play games with us. Why did it mention that gun on the wall in chapter 2? Will it turn out to be useful, I wonder? But despite this, realism is the dominant form of the novel. The baton. But there has always been a countercurrent to this dominance. In the 1700s, Lawrence Sterne's Tristram Shandy played with page layouts, had long circumlocutions, uncertain characters, illogical plot development, and so on. At the end of the 19th century and the beginning of the 20th, writers like Henry James and Joseph Conrad wrote fiction which demanded more work of its readers to discover what was going on. The assured and often comforting narrative voices and final endings of Charles Dickens or George Eliot were missing, leaving a sense of confusion. The next generation of writers, James Joyce and Virginia Woolf and others, now clumped together as modernist writers, questioned realism in much more dramatic ways, using different forms of writing and style in an attempt to get closer to a representation of consciousness. Famously, Wolfe wrote that life is not a series of gig lamps symmetrically arranged. Life is a luminous halo, a semi-transparent envelope surrounding us from the beginning of consciousness to the end. That is, roughly speaking, Wolfe was working out ways to resist the realist conventions of the novel, in which one thing followed as a consequence of another in a linear chronology on the way to a satisfying narrative closure at the end. She wanted to resist this because, simply, modern life just isn't like that. Not only is closure hard to achieve in life, because the threads rarely all tie up, but our psyches seem to leap backwards and forwards in time, beset by memories of the past and hopes, fears, and expectations of the future in a complex and demanding world in which less and less seems certain. The more experimental writers of the 1960s and 1970s developed these sorts of ideas. For example, B.S. Johnson wrote his novel The Unfortunates of 1969 on cards so that it could be shuffled and so read and reread in any order, and in this way rejected a linear and chronological narrative and a sense of closure. The novels of the experimental French writer Alain Robbe-Grillet followed geometric and not chronological patterns. Meanwhile, writers like the German novelist Günter Grass and the Colombian writer Gabriel García Márquez were experimenting with magical realism, in which a traditional narrative, which looked like our unmagical world, was suddenly interrupted by the impossible, as if the enchantments of folk tales had broken into the more mundane world. In Grass's The Tin Drum of 1959, for example, the child protagonist, Oscar, decides to stop growing up as a response to the rise of Nazism, and develops a super-powered scream that can damage people and buildings. These were all attempts to question or develop a form of the novel that was not, or not only, realist. The last runner to pass on the baton, the immediate backdrop to the contemporary novel, however, is the literary movement known as postmodernism. This was the last generation's attempt to counter the realism typical of the novel. It's not easy to answer the question, what is postmodernism, quickly or accurately? Because to answer it is to try to answer the question, what was the mood of an age? An issue on which no one will readily agree. The French philosopher Jean-François Lyotard argued in 1979 that postmodernism was incredulity about metanarratives. That is, that we, whoever we were, no longer believed in the great overarching stories which gave meaning to life. We no longer believed in the forward movement of human progress which made every advance seem like another step towards a better world, for example. In this, postmodernism was the apex of the process of disillusionment that Nietzsche saw when he declared the death of God at the end of the 19th century. In contrast, the American critic Frederick Jameson saw postmodernism as the apogee of the meta-narrative of capitalism. If money dissolves all relationships into what they can be bought for, postmodernism is the point at which traditions themselves, depth, he calls it, are destroyed by capitalism, and anything goes. But it's possible, while admitting that all categories are only suggestions, to see some of the outlines of postmodernism in the novel. Postmodernism certainly developed from the techniques of modernism and experimental fiction, and drew easily on magical realism and on the newer global reach of fiction. But perhaps its central characteristic was one of retelling. Postmodern fiction retells in different ways what has been told before. Most importantly, postmodern fiction retells its own telling.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.